Hello, everyone, and welcome to the EdWeb webinar supporting multilinguals with podcasts and video lessons. We are so delighted that you're here, and we hope to share a lot of great information with you, tips and tricks you can use in your classroom. So first, I'd just like to introduce ourselves. I'm Monica Brady-Myerov. I am the founder and CEO of ListenWise. We are a podcast audio-focused program that uses audio in the classroom to help ELs build their language skills and literacy. And I am so thrilled to be joined by Tan Huynh, who is located across the globe from me, and he'll tell you a little bit more about himself, but is just a really distinguished ELD educator with many, many years of experience that he's going to be sharing with us today about how he uses video and audio in his classrooms to build language skills. Tan, do you want to say hello and tell us a little more about yourself?
ID, and good morning. It is 5 o'clock in the morning, and I'm so excited to be here. I teach grade all of grade 8 and art of grade 9, and so I go to drama classes, visual arts classes, social studies classes, and science classes, and music classes to help students because there's content language in every single one of those content areas. So I'm so excited to be here with all of you. I see people from New York, Harrisburg, Texas, Columbia, and even people from New Jersey. Hello, Shilpa. So it's lovely to see friends here.
And Tan is in Cambodia, if you're wondering why it's 5 o'clock in the morning where he is. All right, let's get started about talking about supporting multilinguals with podcasts and video. So we already introduced ourselves, but I should say we're both authors. That's the one thing we didn't share. Tan has got a DIY PD guide, and I've written a book on listening and learning. So you can check both of those out if you want to learn more about our approach to education. We welcome you to do that. Now, for those of you who have not heard of ListenWise, I want to tell you a little bit about it because we're going to be talking about the tool throughout the webinar. It's an online platform that curates engaging, relevant, multimodal lessons for grades 2 through 12. They're pre-made podcast lessons and quizzes that can be differentiated and scaffolded for all learners for teaching content and language. So this is great for English learners, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later, how specifically it can apply. And our aim is to expose students to authentic vocabulary that is spoken authentically in factual situations that can spark academic conversations using compelling real-world podcasts that are paired with the videos. And you can go on listenwise.com and get your free trial for 30 days and just discover this incredible collection we have of audio stories. We're going to touch on a few of them tonight, but really encourage you to get on listenwise.com and check them out for yourself. So I'm going to turn it over to Tan to start talking first about making videos comprehensible. And I will say, ListenWise has recently added videos as well. We'll be talking about those coming up. But when dealing with multilingual learners, you want a multimodal approach, right? And videos is something that Tan has spent a lot of time thinking about the best ways to incorporate it. So I'm going to turn it over to you, and you can guide the slides and walk us through the way you incorporate video into your classroom.
The main way that I, you're seeing my classroom right now is, or the classroom that I was at previous, was when I was a social studies teacher, and I often use videos to teach content. As a language as an English language specialist, now I still teach videos in my classes, and when I go to content classes like social studies and other science classes, I see them using videos as well. So it's so integral to what we do. It's a great way to learn, but and there are ways to make it accessible. Can you type in the group chat and answer this question? I know that you told me where you're from, but tell me the grade you teach and just say, like, the best part of teaching blank is. So I currently teach eighth grade and ninth grade. So the best part of teaching eighth graders is that they're always energetic about everything and have opinions about everything. So tell me about what do you love about teaching your grade so I can see what grade you're in working with. And I'll read responses as you type them through. Sharon says that the best part of teaching adults, oh, wow, is that they try so hard. Sharon, I want to say thank you for teachers who work with adults like my mother before. You are the re- you give her a lot of confidence in people like her. So thank you for that. Aaron says that grade 9 and 10 world history, they're so curious and have lots to share. And right now there's lots of history that you can, I'm sure, share about current conflicts. It's great. Marie said, teaching 11th grade. We have a lot of 11th graders, high school teachers here. The best part is that they take more responsibility for their learning. And they want to get into the best colleges. Yes, they're always college-driven. And then we also have 5th and 3rd graders. Hello, Ava. K-4, they're so funny. Elementary school kids are fabulous kids. They give me a lot of gray hair when I taught in 5th grade, but also lots of hugs. So thank you for that. Let's continue on to the next part of the slide. You can feel free to keep typing. In my group, the kids that I teach, that we have students who are beginners all the way to intermediate fluent. We have refugee students, scholarship students, gifted and talented, learning support. And 90% of my students, because I work in international schools, come from multilingual families. We're going to do two lesson demonstrations, one on videos first, and then the second one on podcasting. And then we'll show you how I would teach podcasting and videos in my class through these very quick lesson demonstration. But the focus here, when you're working with multilingual students, students who are learning another language, but students who don't speak another language, is comprehensible input. If the thing we're teaching is not comprehensible to students, there's no output. So everything we're doing is focusing on how can we make content more accessible to students, for students. Videos is a fantastic way of doing that, but how do we make that happen? Well, one way is we can take sketch notes as we watch a video. So for example, when there's ListenWise, you're watching a ListenWise video, you can have students not just passively watch, but actively interact. And this is what you're seeing from Marisa last year when we were online on the 2nd of September. So this is the video. This is something you're actually seeing from a student who I worked with during online. We were learning about why Bangkok is sinking, and we learned about something called land subsidence. On a scale of 0 to 5, 0 being like, I have never heard of land subsidence, and 5 being like, oh yeah, I can actually teach land subsidence. Can you type in the group chat, where are you, Sherry? Good to see you, Sherry.
Yeah, Tan, and I'm sure that concept for English learners is probably difficult. So even I see a lot of zeros from teachers not understanding or have not having heard that concept before. I can imagine to make it comprehensible for an English learner is even more difficult.
Right. Like, how do we make this happen? Let me show you that. And I see, wow, Fatima, 4. What is your connection to land subsidence? That's awesome. You can type in the group chat for everyone to see. Okay. Let's keep going on here. We're going to watch, so I'm going to move into the lesson demonstration now. So we're going to watch a video all about land subsidence. This video is going to help us understand why Bangkok is sinking, because there are other cities around the world that are sinking. Okay? So all you do is take out a piece of paper, and I'm going to have you take notes. I'm going to say certain words for you that you for you to write down, and I'm going to ask you to draw certain things. Remember that sketch notes are images plus text. Like labels. Let's start watching here.
This morning, California is facing a different kind of emergency. The state's water crisis is impacting one of the world's most important farming regions, the San Joaquin Valley. The ground is literally sinking by up to 1 foot a year. Ben Tracy shows us how the land is becoming as unstable as the water supply.
I know a lot of you from California, so we're going to be visiting you right there today. By the way, that you could do this exact same thing in ListenWise. I'm just modeling without a ListenWise video.
Every 6 weeks, Michelle Sneed visits this white shed. She checks the pulley system and records a measurement. The numbers show that the ground beneath her feet is sinking.
We're measuring the highest rates we've ever measured here, among the highest rates ever measured in the entire world.
Sneed is a government hydrologist and says parts of California's Central Valley are dropping by 1 foot each year. Some areas are 10 feet lower than they used to be.
We would have had many, many feet of dirt above our heads right now.
That's right. We'd be standing 10 feet higher than we're standing right now.
So land subsidence is when the land sinks. The land where they're on right now has sunk in so much that in the past, if these two people were to stay, be on each other's shoulders, that's how high the land was. Let's find out why the land has sunk to so much.
This is why the ground is collapsing. California's farmers are pumping groundwater as fast as they can in order to keep their crops alive during a drought that has left them.
We're going to stop right here. We're going to pause. You notice that I'm pausing intentionally for certain parts. This, we're going to actually see this here. This is a pump, and these are crops. These are two important words that you're going to be using in your sketch notes, but also in your writing later for the end of the class.
Them high and very dry. But when this much water is pumped out of the aquifer below ground, the clay between the pockets of water collapses, and the ground starts to deflate like a leaky air mattress.
This is a perfect time to now take out your piece of paper.
In order to keep their crops alive during a drought that has left them high and very dry. But when this much water is pumped out of the aquifer below ground, the clay between the pockets of water collapses and the ground starts to deflate.
Okay, now they're stopped to the right spot. This is what we're going to do. So I'm talking to my students. You could do this too. It would be really great. Take out a piece of paper that's bigger than a sticky note, and I want you to draw this picture. As you draw this picture, not very detailed, very, very simple, I'm going to go through and you're going to label things on your sketch note. Okay? The first thing I like you to draw on the left-hand side is land. Draw from the left-hand side here over and then have a dip down the middle like a valley and then up the other side of the valley and then over straight. And then draw that red line and call it original ground level. Normally, I would be going a lot slower, but because we want to make sure we have time for the podcasting part, we'll go quickly through this. I would like you to draw crops here. You can draw any of your favorite crop. You might draw cabbage. You might draw some fruit. You might draw like oranges and apples, like trees that produce fruit or things that produce crops like corn or wheat. And now farmers need this because without water, we can't actually buy our food. Where do we get all the water for? Well, the farmers pump water out of the ground. So draw this pump right here and make sure to draw arrows all the way up. This part here is called ground water. It's water that is soaked up from the rain and it seeps all the way down. And it's hundreds of years old and it's all the way down there. What we do is we pump the water out. And then when we pump the water out, the clay right here becomes dry. So write the word dry clay in the middle. When clay is dry, it cannot support the weight of the topsoil. This is called topsoil above. It can't support the weight of whatever is above. And so therefore, it sinks. Brittle is like when you take it's October, so some places the leaves are changing and it's really crisp. And when you touch it and you push it between your fingers, it becomes brittle and it dries and it easily cracks and crumbles. So that's the same thing with sand here, with clay here. So that is land subsidence. Okay, I'm gonna stop the lesson demonstration now. Look at your notes here. Look at how you've added things to labels to your sketch note, how things are labeled. Like this was not labeled at all, but I use the words groundwater, wet clay, topsoil, deep well pumping. This is called deep well pumping. The arrows being going up to the crops, people are pumping the water out, and this is causing land subsidence. Can you type in the group chat 0 to 5, 0 being like, I have no idea what land subsidence is, and number 5 is like, oh yeah, I could possibly teach this lesson. Can you type in the group chat? Wow, so look, wow, now there's 4 and 3, 3.5. Great. Can you type in the group chat? How did I help you move from, some of you were 0 and 1 and 2 to a 5? What did I do? And it's okay if you're a 2 or 3, not a problem. What did I do to make this video comprehensible for you? Yes, Robert, use visuals. I did. I stepped by step prompting. That's right, Diana. Everything is a prompt right there. We use lots of vocabulary, intentional vocabulary words. Rachel said, I really like seeing the words on the right-hand side. And did you notice? This is an actual lesson. So the student that I had was from China, and he really needed to know these words in Chinese so I could help him. The other kids, there were like about 8 different languages in the room, but this kid was a beginner kid, so he needed, I focused on him in particular. Definitions and pictures made it very understandable, absolutely. I guided you through the steps instead of, the worst thing we could do with videos, and this is like the most important part, is that we just push play, and at the end, we do like comprehension questions. When you work with ListenWise with their videos, pause frequently as much as possible. And at the most important part, have them stop and take notes. And the way we take notes is by having kids draw pictures, right? And label them, because then these words they can use in their writing. Let me show you. So I did a very quick quiz for kids at the end. Like I when we did this virtually, I said, okay, here are letters A to E. When I say B, type in what B is. And sometimes I'll say, tell me what letter crops it are. And then so students would type the word E right there. So that's just showing you assessing students. I also showed students, very important, the word wet clay and dry clay, because they're going to be writing about that later in something like this. This is the comprehensible output part. So the first part is comprehensible input. It's not just about, we make it accessible for students to understand with ListenWise videos or any videos you find. But then we also have to help students show they understand it in using academic specific language or discipline specific language. So this means this is what I do. I create a little text box for students and I put the sequence of ideas on the left-hand side, like topic, sentence, evidence, and then explain, and I say, what is land subsidence? How does land subsidence occur? Explain what causes land subsidence. And students on the right-hand side, there are optional possible sentence starters to help them. Language subsidence is, this phenomenon occurs when the main cause of land subsidence is. Do you notice how I'm also teaching students grammar at the same time? For example, this phenomenon occurs. Like the occur has an S at the end, but I'm not teaching them grammar directly, right? So what students would do is they would work into small groups. Like I would work with Monica. Let's say that I'm a student, or Monica and Ava would be sitting together and they'd be working on this together because it's collaborative. The biggest secret in teaching was this, when I realized this about 8 years ago. Students do not come to school for us. They do not come to school for the building. They do not come to school for the curriculum. They come to school for each other. So they love to learn together. So if they love to be together, why don't we make all learning experiences social? So you saw that I did like the direct instruction, which is not social, but the second part of this writing part is social, where students are co-creating the text together. I see some questions here. Yes, how does a student balance drawing looking at... Go ahead.
No, I was just going to help you with the question, and because I think it's an interesting one that I had too. How do they sketchnote while also watching the video? Do you play it a couple of times, or do you ask them?
I go a lot slower.
So you pause it more frequently.
Yes. So what you see here is I pause frequently, but when you see Ramisa's stuff right here, it's like several pauses. It's like, All right, students, I want you to draw this. I'm going to give you about 15 seconds to draw this. And it reminds me, it was a quick drawer, and so she had time to, like, color. But I tell kids, like, you don't have to color. Just draw. And what I want you to do is, like, label. Right? So it's, like, intentional pausing. That's the biggest thing.
Yeah, and your instructions were very clear, I felt, on the where to draw. You explained the valley, the original ground level. You know, you really talked it through in a very comprehensible way.
Yes, I would love everyone to write this down, what Monica is saying. So this is the model. Dr. Brown said, clear is kind. I intentionally stopped slowly and gave very clear instructions because I wanted to be clear for students so that I could be kind to them as well. Yes, so that this is the version for middle school and high school, they're writing paragraphs. But for elementary school version, this is what I would do. I would have something called sentence patterning chart. It starts with a noun, there are verbs, and there's detail at the end. So I would put like, oh, the blank is pumped out deep below the ground. So I would have a vocabulary bank for kids, or kids would use discussional and they would say, oh, groundwater is pumped out deep below the ground. And then we would go to the next one as an elementary school context. The blank use or the water to grow fruit. So who uses groundwater? And kids would talk and they would say, oh, the farmers. Yes, the farmers use. Notice how farmers is more than one. So use becomes just no S. And in Spanish, we say utilizan. There you go. That's an example here.
That's great. There was a question, too, about using this with newcomers, which I think that addresses not just elementary students, but students who have a lower level of language could really make this accessible by breaking it down and adding some potentially their native, their first language.
Yes, exactly. And this is how you would do it. I have more examples. Dr. Katie Topless, a fantastic example of seeing sentence patterning chart as well. Okay. Well, maybe Sherry can add. Dr. Katie Topless in the chat. Okay. So the things that I just shared with you about like pausing videos in a lecture can be applied to texts and experiences as well. But we'll continue to talking about that with the podcast next. But I'll let Monica continue here.
Yeah, so really the foundations of everything he's talking about are based on, you know, the PSYOP model and the design. The way we structure our ELD lessons is around the design for learning or the UDL framework. So you're learning through multimodalities that offers all these alternate pathways for engagement and understanding and expression. I mean, Tan just talked through multiple ways that students can show what they are learning. By drawing a picture, by labeling things, by sharing with their partner. So in order to engage English learners and really all students, lessons need to connect to their interests, provide them multiple access points through listening, speaking, reading, or viewing meaningful. And that helps build the background and helps them with different strategies to learn the important parts of this content. So it's just a great example of all of these foundations of the PSYOP model. So good on you, Tan. It's great that you're able to share this with us. So now let's move a little bit more into podcast too, because video it's probably fairly obvious to everyone that video, pictures, that helps people learn languages because you can see something and say it or label it. It's a little more difficult with podcasts and just audio. But the reality is, in life, most of these learners are only going to be hearing things. So you really need to help them build up and work their listening muscle. And that's where using podcasts can help. So ListenWise gives you a variety of ways to do this. I spoke earlier about it in general, but I want to dig a little bit more in detail about how our offerings can help English language learners, because we've recently added a whole bunch of features that speak specifically to English learners and teachers like yourselves who are looking for multiple ways to engage with them. So our newly launched ELD lesson library has multimodal lessons providing several exciting new features, including video, as Tan said, optimized assignment experience for emergent MLs. Basically, the way we've structured the way you can do online assignments is a lot more chunked and easy to digest. We also have immersive Spanish language supports with plans to expand to more languages. But I know it's exciting. We have the transcript of the audio is now in Spanish. The write-up of the synopsis is in Spanish. The questions are in Spanish. This is something we've heard many times that really make it accessible, especially for emergent learners. So with these new features, ListenWise is making it easier than ever for teachers to support English learners of all levels. And it's also helping them develop not just conversational and academic language, but it builds background knowledge and hearing authentic language in context. And I can't emphasize enough how when you're listening, you know, you're able to absorb A lot more than you might be able to speak or write even, and giving students opportunities to hear a lot of different accents and authentic voices and topics is a way to really expand their vocabulary in an interesting manner. So we're going to go to one example here that I know Tan has used. So I'll turn it back to you to talk about how you use this podcast on ListenWise to build language acquisition for your students.
Thank you, Monica. So this is what so let's say that I'm working with Harriet Tubman in an Underground Railroad. One way to not do it is, let me show you this. This is one way to not do it, just to play a podcast like this.
Welcome to Bedtime History. This is your host and storyteller, Breck. So who is Harriet Tubman? Harriet Tubman was a human rights activist and former slave. She fought during her lifetime for the end of slavery. This is known as abolition. She helped many people escape slavery during her lifetime. She helped them get to freedom through a secret route called the Underground Railroad.
Yeah, I mean, let's right go there, back in time. You've already lost me even saying abolition. What could that mean? Like,
right,
if I didn't
exactly
know that word, that would be my time to tune out.
Right, exactly. So can you type in the group chat, why do you think that's the method of me playing the video or the podcast for the next 3 minutes is not a helpful strategy? Can you type in the group chat? And sadly, this is what I did when I first started teaching. Like, okay, we're going to watch this video all the way through. Okay, it comes monotone. Yes. Oh, there's Chinese, Persian, and Middle Eastern. I'm like, wow, okay. Crystal said, minds will wander and not listen. Absolutely. Aaron said, very vocab heavy. So, so heavy. And it's so boring when we're just listening this way. Yet we want to give them the practice of listening to academic level texts, which are in ListenWise podcasts, right? Because they will experience this in the future when they go to colleges, when they work, they'll hear people talking for a long time. And so how do we develop that practice? We'll show you this. Students will become confused by the academic words. Students may tune out, I'm sure, doing it. That's right. Ava said, you will need to scaffold. Yes. How do we scaffold comprehensible input? Yes. No scaffold, no prior knowledge activity. Mary Ann, high five. Did you have access to my slides? Oh my goodness. Vivian said, it's so unengaging. Paula said, I didn't have any prep of what's going on. So let me stop there and let me prep you.
I mean, especially saying like you had no idea what you were about to listen to. There was no preparation.
Exactly. Here's the preparation. Ready? All right. I'm going to model for this. Everyone, can you please type in the group chat, please share a time when you helped someone or when someone helped you or when you have seen someone helping another person. This can be in a movie. This can be hearing a story. Can you type in the group chat when you saw someone help someone else or when you help someone else? Monica, would you read the responses and can you read?
Yeah, someone said I tutored my cousin. I know I saw somebody help someone recently at the grocery store, helping a student with a term paper, students using technology to speak to each other. Oh, Sharon raked her neighbor's leaves. That's awesome. Another one person teaches curling, tying shoelaces for my kids at soccer games. These are all big and little ways of helping each other. And it's such a great activity.
Yes.
It actually makes you feel good too, to talk about things you've either seen that are helping or that you've done yourself.
Right, because sometimes, here's the intentionality. Sometimes kids are like, I've never helped anybody, so I can't relate. But they have seen maybe someone else do it, right? Let's continue on with this. The questions here. Can you type in the group text? Why did you help this person? Can you type in the group text? Why did you help these people or this person? Or why do you think someone helped this person or that group? Monica,
they're responding because I can. She looked lost. They had a problem. I wanted to help. My neighbor was overwhelmed by the job. That's the leaf raker. Thank you, Sharon.
Yeah.
Level of frustration. I helped because it's a skill that needs to be learned. Yeah. And I love just Maria just says, I wanted to help. Sometimes that can be the only reason you need.
Yes, sometimes all we... So we're going to be watching, we're going to be learning about Harriet Tubman, and she wanted to help as well, okay? But notice how I'm doing this in... I love teaching online because I could get to students to respond this way a lot, right? In person, it's a little different, but the more you get students to stop, connect to something in the text before they get to the text, before they get to the video, before they get to the podcast, you already have engagement there. You're already priming the pump for them to understand. Perfect. You also get to know a little bit more about students, right? Because I forgot that Sherry curls. And so this is a wonderful way to incorporate. Right? So this is what I would do. I would take the text. So this is the transcript. And I'm not changing anything.
Yeah, just to say that what you're showing here is what you see on ListenWise. So the transcript is there for every story, and it actually highlights the words as they're read authentically. So it is a great support. But what you do is take it another step in a chunking method using the transcript. Yes. But I just wanted to explain what we're looking at here.
Awesome. Thank you, Monica, for doing that. Thanks. This is, by the way, a wonderful example of co-teaching. So like Monica and I are co-teaching, co-partnering. When she feels like there's a part for her to add, she does that. And then I just back off and I'm like, yes, go ahead, Monica. So this is an example of co-teaching when the content teacher and the English language specialist are partnering together. So I would take the first section of the first few sentences or our first sentence of the text, and I would put it on a Google slide. Then I would add an image that's connected to that. And then I would play the podcast for kids. So let's listen to this, what I'm doing here.
She helped many people escape slavery during her lifetime. She helped them get to freedom through a secret route called the Underground Railroad. But let's go back in time and see how she became such an amazing woman.
Okay, so we just read this text. We just listened to this podcast out loud. Let's do the next activity. Let me go back to my slides. I would ask, all right, students, let's answer this question together. To free the slaves, Tubman had to secretly help slaves escape from their masters by using something called. Can you type in the group chat? And when I say don't do it yet until I say 3, 2, 1, type. So I'm gonna read this again. To free the slaves, Tubman had to secretly help slaves escape their masters by using something called. 1, 2, 3, enter. Yeah, you got it. Perfect. You can stop there. So right away, I'm assessing students' knowledge. And the thing is, I'm connecting the text here to a little bit of processing. Students had to know this text. The next part, I had to then process the text. So instead of me being like, let's listen to this podcast all the way through, it's like, here's a really important part. You have to know what the Underground Railroad is. But there's no picture attached to the podcast, which is fabulous. We're just supporting students by adding a picture to the podcast and then adding a sentence starter. But did you notice I'm also teaching students academic text to free the slaves? That's a phrase, comma. So I'm having students do that. Here's another way of doing it. I would put this on the board and I would say, okay, ready, turn, talk to your partners, but start by reading this, to free the slaves. 3, 2, 1, students would read the text to themselves. To free the slaves, Tubman had to escape, and they would answer the question out loud. So they're getting practice reading. So this is wonderful that we're using podcasting, which is listening, but we're giving students an opportunity to read, but we're giving an opportunity to speak as well. So this is how it's integrated. It's called a swirl, which is part of a book that written by Andrew Hagensfeld and Marie G. Dove about SWIRL, S-W-I-R-L, speaking, writing, interacting, reading, and listening. Let me say that again, SWIRL, S-W-I-L, speaking, writing, interacting, reading, and listening are all integrated together. All right, let's move on to the next part. Let me keep on demonstrating this, and then I'll stop with the lesson demonstration.
Harriet Tubman was born in 1820 in Maryland. Her original name when she was born was Araminta Harriet Ross. She had 8 brothers and sisters, and her parents were slaves. Her parents gave her the nickname Minty, which was short for Araminta.
Araminta Harriet Rose was the name Harriet Tubman was given. Her family like to call her, when I say go, type in the group chat, don't do it yet. What did her family used to like to call her? Let me give you the text again. Okay, people already typed it. That's fine, Minty, yes. Okay. So here you see that I'm doing the next part of the text. That why did I use Minty is because the next part of the text, they use Minty a lot. And that transition between Harriet Tubman and Minty is confusing for kids. So I am very intentional about the words that I ask students to, the comprehension students have to give me back, the output students have to give me back, right? Everything, if there's one thing you have to learn about, or not learn, but remember about working with multilingual students is everything is intentional. Every single step is intentional. Every single thing that we do is intentional. And I frame it through, how do we make comprehensible input intentional? How do we make comprehensible output intentional? Let's keep going. And that's the end of the lesson. I'll let Monica tag in now.
Yeah, I mean.
Oh, wait, sorry. Can I pause?
Of course, go right ahead.
Sorry about it. So what did you notice about that very, very quick lesson demonstration of the strategy of taking the transcript? Because I forgot to give you time to process. Every time, so this is the thing. Every time you teach something in your class, make sure you have students process. And that's the same thing for adults. So I gave you a concept, a strategy of saying, take the transcript, section it off, putting it into a Google slide or whatever presentation slide, add a visual. And then the next part is add a sentence starter for them to process the content. What did you notice about this strategy? Sure, you're so funny. Type in the group chat.
Manageable mouthfuls. I love it.
What does that mean?
Well, it's true. It's just, it was chunking. I think it's another way to say chunking.
I love it, Sherry.
Yeah, a lot of chunking. I mean, I think that's what I notice as well. And I think that by doing that too, Tan, you're really building up that listening muscle. And you're alerting the students to pay attention because you're going to ask something after they listen. So instead of just playing it from the start to the end, when they don't have a goal for listening, I mean, really what you're employing is a metacognitive strategy to listening, because I've done a lot of research on the neuroscience behind listening. And one of the most important things you can do is set a goal for the listening and tell students what they should be listening for, at least not, maybe not in particular, but if they know that they're going to get a chunked part of it and then ask a question about it, they're going to be listening and trying to anticipate what it is that you may ask them about that.
Oh, I love it. High five, Monica. Monica talked about metacognitive learning. The thing that I want to show you that Rachel just talked about, she said, the map really helped me begin to visualize the journey enslaved people were taking. That's so important because I want to show you this. Here's a metacognitive strategy. When you read a text and you see something that's capitalized, like Underground Railroad, go away. If you don't know what that is, go and Google that and go to Google Image. You'll be able to see that, right? So that's a metacognitive strategy. Why do we teach metacognitive strategies? It's so important to multilingual students is because we do not want them to become dependent upon teachers. We want them to be dependent upon strategies. If not, they'll become quote-unquote long-term English learners. When students become dependent upon strategies, they become independent of the teachers, which is what we actually want. Cool.
That's
so
great.
Now I'll let Martha go. Thank you.
You know, and Tan, before I move on, though, Marianne is asking, do you present the slides with chunks of text before listening to the podcast? Is that right? Or sort of at the same time? Are you showing that visual while they're listening?
So you could do both. So what? But this is what I prefer. The kids don't listen to the podcast all the way through with like what I do, like here in the beginning. We first chunk it first for kids like this. So they comprehend what the text is step by step by step. And then the next day after we finish processing this or the end of the class, we listen to the podcast in its entirety. So they get that uninterrupted experience of processing, but now they already have the visuals. Now they already have the comprehension. Normally podcasts are not like this, but we want to build up their capacity to listen for things in the text or create mental images in the text. So I tell kids, all right, you have images of Harriet Tubman. You have images of Underground Railroad. I am simply now going to put this text up for you and push play. And it's going, you're going to see the transcript move. It's lovely. The little red words follow. So kids have that little support, but they also are hearing the podcast uninterrupted. So I give that practice to them. So there you go. Great question.
It is. And I love that you're using multiple listens, because that's something that we also recommend as one of the scaffolds on ListenWise, is we give you three different ways or things to listen for, because it is a demonstrated strategy that listening to something multiple times for multiple reasons can give you many opportunities to learn from one text that happens to be a podcast. It could be a focus on grammar. It could be a focus on content. There's so many different ways. Each lesson that we put together on ListenWise includes this aligned content with language objectives and key concepts, as well as listening comprehension and discussion questions and all the vocabularies to support comprehension. So I guess what I think is special about ListenWise is that all of these things, not all, but many of the things you've been talking about, Tan, that you do, we already do for you. We know you're super busy and it takes a lot of time to deconstruct a podcast by yourself. So ListenWise is taken an approach to that by building a unique design that can scaffold meaning and bring rigorous learning for multilinguals in every classroom. And these new ELD lessons help meet both language and content objectives, because you're talking about a point in history. This story has great historical context about slavery. And it's hard. It's very hard for ELs to access complex texts like this and learning this academic vocabulary, especially when it's completely out of context. Well, Tan, by using the story you've created, the story's created the character of Minty, right? Yes. And Minty was Harriet Tubman, and you learn she's about her family and her background. And by breaking it down and getting people to immediately get into the story by thinking about being a helper themselves, they can identify with them. I just think about all the ways that helps improve not only vocabulary, but content acquisition. Like, I think after this lesson, they will remember the Underground Railroad. So when I think about just the design features that we've developed for the SIOP model, I mean, it's really that the lessons in the ELD library have been designed with this in mind. So they include features to help students build their background knowledge, which you did again, just talking about that Underground Railroad and showing the map. So just by adding that element, and we also have added a lot of photos and other videos to do that for you, it really gets, it accesses comprehensible input such as images, videos, interactive transcripts. And we also include this new native language supports, as I mentioned, such as translations in Spanish and embedded dictionaries. In addition to Spanish, there is a picture dictionary in ListenWise. So if Spanish is not their first language, they could at least look up a word and it'll have a pictorial drawing of it. The lessons are highly scaffolded and they really invite students to use strategies for language learning. And Tan, I love how you say that you don't want students to be dependent on teachers. You want them to be dependent on strategies that they can use for the rest of their lives to figure out the words they don't know, to think critically, and just deepen their understanding of meaningful content. So I invite you again to check it all out and listenwise.com and get a free trial so you can go more deeply. Because the other thing we have is this teacher's guide. I've been talking a lot about the supports that help students understand, but we also understand that you need some guidance and help and time-saving methods, let's be honest. So we outline a sequence of activities that build understanding before, during, and after listening to stories. Tan, you did this just automatically. Before we listened, we talked about how we help someone. During the listening, we chunked it and asked questions. And after the listening, really, after every segment, you asked a question. And you could do that in the classroom too with them. turning and talking or shouting out the name and just getting really like they're involved, they're interacting with the story. And that makes it an exciting lesson. So really the lessons include a variety of opportunities for students to interact with the media and with each other to practice these skills and build academic language. For example, we also have listening organizers. You know, you had a drawing activity, and we have printables that do things like some of it is language identification charts. So just when you hear a phrase, you could check it off. It's just a way to, again, a metacognitive strategy for note taking, following along, and your mind wanders, but you can come back and look at where you are in the story. So that's another kind of great way to do that.
What I loved, let me summarize what all the features of what ListenWise is doing as I'm listening to this. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, you notice how we didn't make the content easier. This is the equity part. When we work with multilinguals, oftentimes things get dumbed down for them because, oh, pobrecito, they're just learning English. No. But we're going to keep the mountain the same height, but we're going to give them multiple paths to get there. We're going to add different tools to that backpack so they can climb that summit. We're not making the mountain smaller. We're just giving more tools to summit the mountain. And that's what ListenWise and all the strategies that we're doing here makes it accessible. If we ever make things easier for kids, this is a flag for equity. We're saying, do we think that multilingual students can achieve just like everyone else? And I didn't make this really difficult text. I didn't dumb it down. I just made accessing it more accessible.
Tan, I love that you say that because what I call it is, I say listening is the great equalizer. Everyone is listening to the same story, but the scaffolds are there to help the students where they're at. And I feel like too often we are changing the height of the story, the difficulty level, the vocabulary level. We're using lower lexile levels written to select stories, the same content for one student that's different, but the language is different for another. But listening is such a great venue for this because you can absorb it and get interested in the story and let what you don't understand wash over you and still get the concept. Whereas I know that can be difficult in reading, right? When you give students reading texts, written texts that are above their grade level, above their ability level, it can be a blocker. But listening, whether it's video or audio, presents a whole different opportunity to keep that high level of expectation with vocabulary, grammar, and content. And everyone is listening to the same story. I love that. And I love how you described it as the mountain, because they're all trying to climb that mountain. And it's helpful for students. And one of the things I think is the most helpful for students is really being able to listen and read at the same time. And this is a demonstrated reading support. It's a demonstrated language learning support that, in fact, it was first identified by a researcher in India who noticed that students or everybody who India has a very large number of semi-literate residents. And what they realized when they watch Bollywood movies is that when they had the words underneath the songs that everybody sang along, it was improving their literacy. So this social scientist created a whole project around this and studied it, created something called Project Read. And he since confirmed that in independent studies and convinced the Indian government to put the transcript of all Bollywood movies and songs on the television so that it can be anybody who's watching it, young or old, can be getting that demonstrated literacy support for language learning, for reading and for language learning. So it's an exciting, it's something that's pretty easy to do when you're using a support like ListenWise. And the other thing, these Bollywood movies are obviously movies too. And that's something that we took to heart after we were primarily audio. And then we thought we really need the videos to help provide more comprehensible input for English learners because visuals are so important when learning a language. So including English captions and Spanish subtitles really helps students support in accessing both language and content at any level of English language proficiency. This is just an example of quizzes as well, because as you pointed out, Tan, you're trying to assess as you go, right? You're trying to understand where your students are. ListenWise has built-in quizzes, and after listening to the story, you could assign one after that Tubman story and see where they are and understand the main point or vocabulary word in context. And now they can be assigned in English or Spanish, depending on students' language proficiency levels. So that's an exciting new development too, is that we realize, you know, you can often, language learners understand a lot more than they can express or maybe even read. So they might be able to listen to that Harriet Tubman story and understand it, but then come to a quiz in English and it's too high level for them. But give them the quiz in Spanish and they're like, oh yeah, I get this. Because all of these skills, the swirl skills, develop at different speeds and levels. And you want to give your students access to being successful on all of these skill points. Oh, we're coming to the end.
That was fast. So, I was also thinking about when you were showing your quizzes, and I know this is so wonderful that ListenWise now has transcripts, a lot of transcripts in Spanish. What I would do is, if your student is literate in Spanish, here's one option. You can create the slide, one like the slide that I just gave you about the Underground Railroad. Have the slide, one side of it is in English and the other side is in Spanish for students who can read, right? Now, for the students who can't read, this is what I would do. I would break students into small groups. Kids who want to listen to it in Spanish, this is what I would do. I would teach kids to take the transcript in Spanish and put it into, take the text and put it into a reader, like a Spanish reader, and have the transcript read to them in Spanish. As the other kids are reading the transcript in English, or having the text read to them in English. So I'm two groups, a group of students reading, having the transcript read to them or through the podcast, and then having the other students listen to the podcast at the same time, possibly, or a different time, but listening to it in Spanish, and then coming together to do the listening activities of like the comprehensible questions throughout. That's one way of doing that. And I just love that ListenWise is like using Spanish quizzes. Like, we're going to learn in English, but maybe your understanding will be in Spanish. This is something called from Dr. Margot Gottlieb, one of the founders of WIDA. She has something called assessments in multiple languages. And this is affirming like the fact that maybe a student really knows about Harriet Tubman, but it has struggling to communicate it. But with this quiz, you can really show students' understanding. It's really thoughtful and responsive. That's so true.
All right, we only have a few minutes left, so I want to make sure everyone has a moment to take the survey. It's anonymous, but we really want to know what you learned, what you thought about this presentation today. So please take a moment, and I know our team just popped that link in the chat, and so did Tan. Tan, I know you love Brené Brown, and you mentioned her before. Clear is kind. I mean, you can't say it any better.
You want so clear we are, everything we're doing is, yes, everything we're doing is being clear for students. And that is kind instruction.
Mm-hmm. Oops, sorry.
And why is that kind instruction? No worries. And the kind instruction really helps students like me and my sister. This is a picture of me and my sister before we left the refugee camp in the Philippines. So we feel your love. Like, the purpose of life is to find your gift, and the purpose of the gift is to give it away. We as immigrant and refugee students feel the gift you're giving every day by working so hard at home and doing these things during your planning periods to make us feel like we are at home. We feel your love.
I feel it. Thank you. We've already answered all the questions in the chat as we went. Otherwise, I'm going to say thank you so much, Tan Huynh. Like, this was fun. I loved being your co-teacher.
And I would, you're a wonderful
do it again
teacher.
Anytime.
This is how I say goodbye to my students in my classroom. They say goodbye to me when I walk in at the door. They say goodbye in any language they like. Can you type in the group chat when you leave? Can you type in the group chat goodbye in any language that you want to say goodbye in? And that's a wonderful way to say goodbye. Adios. Ciao, Gina. Au revoir, Marie. Oh my goodness. Adios. Thank you so much. Monica, Rachel, Ava, again, thank you so much for being here. Sherry, she's writing it. 안녕하세요 in Korean. Adios, muchas gracias. Have a wonderful rest of your day. You could have been anywhere in the world today at 4 or 5 in the afternoon, but you chose here to be with your students and with us. So thank you so much. Bye, everybody.
Yes. Thank you. Goodbye.